Hello. Firstly, thank you for inviting me to come here. This first came about because, and I'm assuming your English is all better than my Estonian, so this all came about. I was invited to join a British Council meeting in Manchester last year, at the end of the summer last year. And it was a whole series of the creative industries from the Baltic states and some of the Nordic countries. And I was asked to do a talk on issues relating to new media, to galleries, and other areas of the creative economy. And I walked into the room not really knowing quite what it was going to be about. And it ended up being the most fantastic, not what I said, actually, but the debate and the discussion afterwards. And I say that because I would really appreciate it. I'm going to talk for a bit, but I would, if you have any questions or observations, or if you're thinking what I'm saying is wrong or right or interesting or not interesting, I would really value a discussion that is beyond that. Because on the one hand, I'm coming here to talk to you about my experiences, but I'm equally keen to hear yours. Because one of the things I've picked up in the very short time I've been here is that the creative economies here are clearly thriving, whether it is through state intervention or simply through individuals who are taking the cudgels of the creative economies and developing them. It's extraordinary for such a relatively small nation quite how vibrant it is. I've picked that up from the outside, and I've picked it up from outside by the websites looking, trawling around from the UK, but also from the short time I've been here. I wanted to talk about old media, new media, museums and galleries. But really, I want to talk about also the engagement with audiences, because a little bit about me. I've been at the Tate for just over a year, and before that, I spent 10 years as one of the directors of the Guardian newspaper in the UK. And the reason why I mention the Guardian newspaper is it's a very liberal, slightly centre-left newspaper, which in itself is interesting, but what's more interesting is it's a very small, essentially, newspaper with an enormous amount of influence. It's only the ninth biggest newspaper in the UK, but it's the largest newspaper in the UK on the website, and it's one of the largest, most read newspapers around the world. And the reason for that is that it has an incredibly open view of how to develop its journalistic model and its business model. As we all know, the business model of journalism is currently breaking apart. It's having a terrible time. Doesn't matter where you are in the world of news there's more news being read by more people, but people don't know how to make money out of it yet. You have to separate the two issues out, and over time, the money will come. But at the moment, people don't know how to work that out. I don't particularly want to talk about that now, but I'm happy to take questions on it afterwards, because I have a lot of experience in that area, and a lot of failures in that area. But I really want to talk about the open model of how I think the creative economies need to work. And at the Tate, in the creative economies, particularly in the worlds of museums and galleries, you have an extraordinary juxtaposition and a contrast between organizations that are fundamentally conservative and sort of fundamentally progressive. And it's a really hard balance to come to successful conclusions on that. And I think some of the things I want to show you here will hopefully illustrate that. My plan is to talk for about half an hour, 40 minutes, and I want to talk really about three things. General developments in web-based applications and web-based technologies for galleries, and how galleries are embracing a much wider audience and saying, actually, maybe people shouldn't have to come to the gallery the whole time, which institutionally is incredibly hard for galleries to get their head around. Because for decades, for centuries, you've had to go to a place to visit the work, in a fairly quiet, hallowed circumstance, and then that's it. And we are now in a situation where clearly through web-based technologies and the internet, we can take our messages all over the place. So I want to spend a bit of time talking about that, a little bit of time talking about the Tate. There's one case study I want to talk you through, which is a case study of the Gauguin exhibition in London that ran between September and January. Can I ask, how many of you have been to London or been to the Tate? Brilliant. So you've seen the big Tate. How many have been to Tate Modern? And how many have been to Tate Britain? Okay, it's always more. In London, there's about 5 million people a year go to Tate Modern, and about 1.5 million people go to Tate Britain. And the two galleries could not be more different. Tate Modern is like, It's a big social space. It's an old power station where the art is clearly at the heart of it. But just next to that is the concept of art as a social space and art as a meeting point and art as a backdrop for people to engage with each other. Tate Britain is a much more formal gallery. Tate Modern, you enter down that ramp, and if you work at Tate Modern, it's brilliant. If you sit, there's places you can sit where the public aren't allowed to go, right above it all, and you see people entering the gallery, and the joy with which they run down that ramp is fantastic, which is completely different to how people enter any other gallery I've ever seen. Other galleries, you go to them, they're very quiet, you have to walk up steps, they're often in very old buildings, it's purely white walls, it's very formal, and it's all about hushed tones. Tate Modern is the polar opposite to that. And I want to talk about that, because that's part of the success, I think, of the Tate. So I want to talk about the Gauguin exhibition, how we did that, and that is sort of relating a very strong exhibition to how we market it, how we made money out of it, and how it became the third biggest exhibition in the Tate's history, which we never thought it would. And it was a real surprise that it was that big. And I want to end, if I may, with some developments that we're doing. I want to show you, it hasn't launched yet, but our website, which is launching in 6 months' time, because it's completely changing. And it's changing on the lines of the things I'm going to talk about now. This is not me, obviously. It's not my children either, but it's how I think most children think when their parents say to them, oh, let's go to a gallery. And the truth is, the experience is not like that. But the way galleries present themselves often leads to, oh, God, I'd rather not do that. And it's a shame, because lots of galleries are missing out. This is a cliched view. I know it's not really like this. But as a parent, I can tell you that going to a gallery is not a child's most exciting Saturday trip. And in my view, it should become so. There's a sweet cartoon, I thought, which was rather lovely, and I think this might be Tate Britain, actually, where it just says, the very, very boring museum. And it clearly isn't boring. They're amazing places. They're places of learning. They're places of wonder. I'm not from the art world. I'm not an art historian. But having spent a year and a half at the Tate, I'm completely in awe of the place, of the work. And, you know, if ever I'm bored at work, having a quick wander around the gallery is just fairly wonderful. It's a great place to be. But interestingly, there's a thing called, I don't know how many of you, there's a podcast, there's a thing called Slate Magazine, which is an online magazine, which is a really good magazine. It's quite irreverent. It's an American mag, and every week they do a podcast called the Slate Gab Fest. And the Slate Gab Fest is a one-hour podcast with three fairly sort of nerdy New York, Upper West Side, sort of geeky, brilliant people who just discuss culture. And they go on about whatever they want to talk about. It's really good. And it can be on any subject. It can be something very serious, something very stupid. And they only talk about a subject for 10 minutes. And there's three of them, and they do between four and six subjects. The podcast lasts about 50 minutes. And I get it every week, and I listen to it, I cycle to work, and I listen to it, and I was really struck by one of them who said, can I say to the museums of the world that your websites suck? Translation of that, bloody awful. You're rubbish. Maybe they don't want their websites to be too good. They want people to come to their museums instead. And I was really struck by that, because I think when you're in the creative industries, and when you are... I hate phrases like this, but in the content business or the provision of content, it's very easy to create websites that are fascinating and brilliant because you have the content. It's completely different if you are manufacturing chocolate bars or manufacturing toilet paper. Why would you want to go to a website of a toilet paper manufacturer or a chocolate manufacturer? They have to work so hard and basically bury the truth of their product and make everything else look interesting. That's not the case, and it was not the case with newspapers where I spent 10 years, and it's not the case in galleries and museums. What we have, we know people want to see, but we present it incredibly badly. And I thought this really struck with me. And I want to talk about I think the world changed online. Are you familiar with the Google Art Project? I think before Google Art Project, there was the world and after. And the really interesting thing about the Google Art Project is that it was only 17 galleries from 9 countries around the world. And I thought that was amazing. Because the Tate was the first gallery to sign up to the Google Art Project. And it signed up to the Google Art Project because my own philosophy is I don't really know what I'm doing most of the time, particularly in the area of online. And to say no is a mistake, generally. You have to, you can always pull out, but you should always, not always, but largely, you should approach these projects with a big yes, let's see what happens. So Google approached us first, and we'll approach a lot of galleries, and we said yes. Generally, when the Tate says yes, or the Louvre says yes, or the big galleries say yes, the other galleries come in. So for Google, it was important that Tate came in. We came in. What's interesting is the galleries that didn't go in, and I'm not going to be critical about those who didn't, but go to the Google website and you'll be surprised by the omissions of some of the major world galleries that are not in it. And I find that extraordinary because they should have done it. Now, they all want to get in it because they've seen what's happened. And if you, it would launch in February the 1st, and we made sure they launched it at Tate because I wanted all the PR to come back to us of how great the Tate is to have been the first one in. We were also the only museum to put a contemporary piece of artwork in there, which is a Chris Ofili painting that I'll show you in a moment. And there, it's an incredible website. It's incredible for many reasons. One, it's incredible because from a practical point of view, they have taken a single picture from each museum and photographed it to, I think it's 14 billion pixels per photograph, which basically means you can see it better than you can possibly see with the human eye. You can go and it's an extraordinary thing. So please go and have a look at it. The other thing they did, which doesn't quite work, but I think is a fantastic experiment, is you're familiar with Google Street View, when you can go up and down anywhere in the world, and I can have a good look around Tallinn before I get here, and you can see where you're staying in London when you go to London. They did that in all the galleries. And it sort of works, but not quite. But it doesn't matter, because it's a great attempt at trying something new. But overall, the ambition of bringing these galleries to people who are frankly unable to go to galleries for whatever reason, they don't live in the country, they live too far away, they don't have the time, I think is an extraordinary experiment. And it will change, and I'll bet you in 2 years' time it looks completely different. But as a trial and as an experiment, it was fantastic. And I suppose my first point on this is to say that when, and it's easy if it's Google, because Google's Google, and you can say no to Google, but generally they're ahead of most people. So you might want to just, you know, play around with them a bit. And we play around with them a lot because we think they're bearing, because they want what we've got, which is fantastic content, and we want what they've got, which is incredibly future-thinking technology and applications. So this was a Google Art project. This is you've got the Frick Collection in New York and Prague, MoMA, the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam. Sorry, I'm talking this way. The Palace of Versailles, you don't have the Louvre, you don't have Musée d'Orsay, you do have Tate, you have the Musée Reina and Sofia Madrid. This is the Chris Ofili painting, I'm going to talk about that. It's an incredibly famous painting that was painted in, it's a painting relating to the death of a young man called Stephen Lawrence, who was a black teenager who was murdered by a bunch of white kids in southeast London, which caused a complete outcry. And this was his memory. It's a big issue in London. It was many years ago, or not many, it's about 20 years ago, and Chris Ofili painted the painting. Now, what you have here, and we can go to it live if you like later, but you can go right in close to the painting. So you can go so close to things that you are unable to see yourself. When you view the painting in darkness, it looks like this. And you very rarely see, because it's hard to show it in both, but that's how the painting should be viewed. And you can go even closer. This is how the Tate Gallery looks on Street View. And here you can go around, you're currently in this building, which is Gallery 9, for those of you who've been there. It's where all the really famous old paintings are. But you can wander around the entire gallery as you choose. This is how they did it. They took lots of, they were there. It took 48 hours to photograph the painting, which I thought was remarkable. They did it over a weekend. Another one which I thought was very interesting was the Guggenheim Museum, where in October 2010 they did a tie-up with YouTube, also part of Google, which was a biennial of creative video, where they put it out to students, to anyone, to upload videos of essentially what as people thought was art videos. And what's really interesting is that 22,000 people uploaded videos on this of art. It's not videos of children playing. This is artworks of video. And the level of engagement is incredibly high. They didn't pick a winner, which I think is quite right, but they picked their favorite 25. And those 25 were then on show in the Guggenheim. I think it's a really, really interesting project. Doesn't cost much, particularly if you have partners. This is a project that you'll be familiar with, Ai Weiwei, the Chinese artist, who's currently, well, no one knows where he is because the Chinese authorities have arrested him for misdemeanors that no one quite knows. A lot of people are really worried about this. He's been locked up for the last month and no one knows where he is. And there's currently a big sort of movement to have him released. The Tate, every year for 5 months, does a project called the Unilever Series, which you may have seen. Ola Solyafin did the, I'll show you some in a minute, did the sun inside the building. This was the one that's just ended about, in fact, a week ago, 10 days ago, on the 2nd of May, which was the sunflower seeds, which was, did any of you see this? Yeah, it was amazing. There's 120 million sunflower seeds, each of which were hand-painted, that were in the building on the floor. Now, the really frustrating thing about this, here you've got people walking on it, and for the first 10 days, the whole point about this is you could walk on it like a beach, you could throw it in the air, you could play around with it, you could do whatever you wanted with it. Unfortunately, because they're made of porcelain, they threw up a lot of dust. The dust was potentially carcinogenic, not to visitors, but if you work there and you're breathing this stuff in for 14 hours a day, 10 hours a day, not a great idea. So after 10 days, people weren't allowed on it anymore, which was a real shame. But the interesting thing about this is that all the Unilever Series works of art take the notion of the gallery into a very different place. The extraordinary thing about these, and I'll show you in a minute, I'll come to them, you never quite know how the audience is going to interact with them. One thing's for sure is they don't just stand there watching the stuff. They get completely engaged. And there was the Carsten Hollis slides that you may have seen. There was the seeds where you were allowed on it, you could do whatever you wanted. There was the sun where people would spend days in the building. And I'll show you some pictures of that. And it's an extraordinary means of engaging with audiences. And it brings in a totally different audience to art on walls, pictures on walls. That's what they actually look like if they're close up. They're all hand-painted and they're all different. What we did with this was we decided, because Weiwei is a very, very politically engaged artist, in the Turbine Hall, which is where this takes place, we installed 12 video booths where anyone could ask Ai Weiwei a question. And the question would be loaded up online and sent to him direct. And he personally responded to hundreds of them, not all of them, but hundreds of them. If you go to our website, there's 27,000 questions that have been posted by visitors to Weiwei. And he has responded to hundreds of them. Most of them are very similar questions. How did you make it? What are they made of? But lots of the questions are more interesting than that. And again, the interesting thing about this was about how do we engage the world of art with its audience and the artists, which is an incredibly difficult thing to do. Partly because lots of artists don't want to, but when they do, how do you do it? This was a technology that allowed us to do it. And that's just people uploading their videos, asking him a question. We called it one-to-one with the artist at the top. And it's next to the artwork itself. I want to spend a little time talking about Facebook. How many of you, I bet you all have Facebook accounts, yeah? Yeah, how many, put your hand up if you've got a Facebook account. And Twitter, how many of you tweet? Very few, which always surprises me. Because I think Twitter is personally much more interesting than Facebook. Much more interesting. Because it allows you to engage. I don't want people particularly to know everything about my life, which in Facebook you sort of do. But on Twitter you can retain your privacy, but engage in a world that is very interesting. Much more interesting than that is what it can do for your engagement with your audiences and the outside world. So Tate is very big on Facebook, but it's actually bigger on Twitter. We have about 350,000 Twitter friends, and this has all happened in the last 4 or 5 months. By next year, we'll have 1 million, in my view, or maybe more, because it allows us to engage with audiences in a way that we never thought was possible. So each day, we send out about anything between 2 and 4 tweets on stuff that's going on in the gallery. Now, this is not academic material. This is interesting stuff that is happening in the gallery. So one of the tweets we do every Friday, for example, we send out a tweet of what the weather will report. It says the weather's going to be like in the weekend in London, and we choose a picture from the collection that best represents the weather. It's a very lovely way of engaging your audiences. It's not academic, it's not particularly intelligent, it's just fun. We also have very academic sessions, which sometimes are called Ask a Curator, where a curator can come in and engage with an outside audience. But what it's really doing is allowing us to talk to an audience one-to-one and for them to talk to their friends. So for every tweet you send out, it'll get retweeted potentially to thousands more. If you do nothing else after this session, please go and join Twitter, because I think it's the thing that's going to change how audiences, museums engage with their audiences. And the bigger museums, the Metropolitan Museum, MoMA, Tate, are fully engaged in this world now in a way that I think is brilliant and is bringing us much closer to our audiences. Culturally, it's very difficult to get people to do this. My experience on this is really undemocratic. And I think the only way to get people to do this is if the people at the top tell the people in organizations they have to do it. When I was at the Guardian newspaper, the editor is possibly the most progressive editor I've ever met. He's a man called Alan Rusbridger. And if you ever get a chance to hear him speak, you should go. He's brilliant. He came back. His view on the digital world, unlike most newspapers, is you better embrace it all. About 5 years ago, he said, look, I remember he walked into, we were in a board meeting, he said, look, I don't know what to do about this new technology. All I think we should do, everyone in the organization needs to open a Facebook account and a Twitter account, which is a remarkable thing to say. He didn't say you have to use it, but you better open one and you better know how it works, because your audience knows how this works. And if this is about understanding your audiences and what they want and how you want to engage with them, you better play with them. So everyone did. Because of that, The Guardian is now one of the most digitally developed newspapers around the world, because from the top, the leadership said, you had better do this stuff because everyone outside is doing. I'm always amazed how few people are on Twitter. Facebook, they're on it, but they're on it for different reasons. But Twitter is a way for organizations that you work with and for to engage with their audiences in a way that I think is unparalleled. And I think Twitter matters because it's an incredible form of distribution. When I wake up in the mornings now, I used to go straight to the Guardian website to find out about the news. I don't anymore. I go to Twitter first, which is ridiculous. If you think about it, it's extraordinary. And I do it because the people I've chosen to follow are people who are influential in the news and influential in the art world, and they tweet and they tell me what's going on. I learned about Osama bin Laden's death, not through the news, but through Twitter. And I'm learning about what's going on in Northern Africa through Twitter, not through the news. And I would urge you, just sign up. The thing that people get scared of, and I don't work for Twitter, so I don't care if you do or don't, but I just think it's an amazing thing. What's interesting, I don't tweet that much because I don't really know what to say, and I'm not quite sure what my voice should be. And do I talk personally? Do I talk from my professional point of view? I don't know. But the interesting thing is the people I follow. And what they say is much more interesting than what I've got to say, and I'd urge you to do that because Twitter matters because it's an incredible form of distribution. It allows your message and message of others to be engaged with in a brilliant way. It's absolutely where things are happening first. It doesn't matter what you're into, whether it's football, culture, politics, you will find it in Twitter because people on the ground are twittering all the time, and it's fascinating. As a search engine, it absolutely rivals Google because it's not a technological aggregation tool, it's a human aggregation tool. And things that trend on Twitter are not because the algorithm of Google are saying they are, it's because people are doing it, which is very interesting. It's a formidable aggregation tool, similar point. It's a fantastic form of marketing. I use it all the time for marketing reasons because it doesn't look like marketing. When the Tate, we opened a Joan Miró show two weeks ago in London. We tweeted it furiously. We told everyone it's opening, and people are very pleased to get those sorts of messages in that way because it's not like a marketing tool, but it works very well as one. It's much more diverse in terms of the people who use it. It's a level playing field, has an incredibly long attention span, has a very long tail. You can play around with it and go backwards in time quite far. It creates communities of interest that are very interesting, and it's a brilliant agent of change. So I think it's an incredibly potent form of engaging with your audiences within the creative industries, and it's massively underused. A couple more before I move to the GoGang example. The Museum of London, if you go around London, any city is, Tallinn's the same, there are places of immense historic interest that have been captured through artworks but essentially lost in time. This is an application called Street Museum, which is from the Museum of London. And what they do is they take a place, this is Piccadilly Circus in London, they tell you, this is up in Liverpool. This is in London. This is, and they'll take a painting from, this is a painting from the 17th century when the River Thames froze over. If you take a picture of where you are and you give the geolocation map, it will tell you, it'll pick an artwork from history of exactly the same place. So if I'm standing here looking to the old city of Tallinn, there will be paintings in your national collection that are just that. Photograph it, it immediately scans it, and this pops up. And it's, then it overlays it, which I think is a fantastic way of presenting art, which engages audiences, again, in a slightly different way. Here in Carnaby Street in London, center of the swinging 60s, that's a painting from a photograph from 1968, which if you overlay it on the present day, it looks like that. So, and it's just an interesting form of if art is in some aspects a repository of history and the passage of time, this is a brilliant way of presenting it. This is a brilliant one. This is outside Buckingham Palace. This is when in 13, the suffragettes, or in the early 20th century, the suffragettes protested for the rights of women to vote, which now seems insane, that women were never not allowed to vote, but as little as 100 years ago, they couldn't vote. And this is one of the Pankhurst sisters being arrested, having chained herself to the front gates of Buckingham Palace. So it brings history alive in a way that is hard to do, and you can now. This is, again, just how, a shoeshine person in Piccadilly Circus in London. This is an old outside Albert Docks in Liverpool. You get the idea, you get the gist. This is another one called Art Finder. Now, Art Finder allows you to basically create your own collection of art and allows you to upload images, download images, and create your own gallery. Here we have, this is sort of more traditional, which you will have too, which is sort of the audio guides, which I think are a sort of delicious way of finding more about art. But the problem with these things is that most adults don't want to walk around with headphones in galleries because they think they look stupid, which is a shame because, and I understand that, and we've done research and I know why that's the case. But if we're now moving to this, if you didn't have to walk around with this, but you could walk around with your mobile phone, with your own earphones in, people would do it a lot more. And so the ability for people to understand what they're seeing, you would look less stupid and or feel less stupid. You don't look stupid, but you think you do, if you could upload it and go to iTunes and get it down for free. And we're now doing this, other galleries are now doing this, and this is turning to be the way forward of once you're in the gallery. So let me turn to Tate, if I may. This was in 1976. This was the block of bricks that, for those of you in the art world, you'll know this. It's a Carl Andre work, which I suppose was the point where modern art and the rest of the world clashed in a way that was sort of remarkable. This was a defining point, certainly in the UK, of what the traditional world saw the insane stupidity of modern art, and the world of modern art thought was the wonderful joyousness and creativity of modern art. And this, for many people, this is where this created a complete scandal when this was bought by the Tate Gallery. And it started the whole debate of, is this art? Which I think is a slightly stupid debate, but it's one that this piece of artwork, which you can still see in the UK, and it's in the Tate. It's basically a series of bricks. From then on, the Tate has moved on. The Tate Modern opened in 2000. And this was, I think, in 2003, where the artist, Oliver Eliasson, basically put the sun inside the building. Did any of you come to London to see this? It was the most incredible thing you've ever seen. You can imagine the Turbine Hall in London, this enormous, at the far end, he put this, I don't know how they did it. This was the sun. And they had put it in the building. Obviously it isn't. But and they had mirrors at the top of the building. And people would come and lie and lay around and just chill out and come to visit and in complete awe of this. If you Google this, it's a million stories about this thing. It was called Oliver Lyons, I think it was the Sun Project. And it was one of those things where art suddenly clicks in a way that you didn't imagine. I was working at the Guardian newspaper then, and we sent a journalist down, and we sent a load of journalists down to spend the whole day there, do nothing, just see how people are responding. And it was incredible thing. I took my son was at that point, my oldest son was 7. And I said, okay, we're going to go and see the sun. They put it in a building. And he thought, you know, Dad, you're mad. What are you talking about? And I did, and he sort of believed me. And we spent hours in there. I've never spent hours in the gallery with my children, ever. And we spent about 3 hours in this, just chilling out and doing nothing, and mostly watching how people watched it. Because the brilliant thing about galleries, I think the galleries that really get it, is they understand that galleries work because people like watching other people watching the work, as well as looking at the work themselves, which I think is a really important distinction, and I think it's an interesting one. Anyway, that was a massive project. This was another one. This was Louise Bourgeois, the spiders that were there for some time. This is in 2007, sorry. There were some inside the building, there were some outside the building. This was the one inside the building. This was Anish Kapoor, you may have seen that. That was an incredible one that took the whole length of the building. You couldn't interact with it in the same way, but it filled the building. This was an interesting one. This was Doris Salcedo, The Crack, where from one end of the building to the other was essentially a fissure in the earth. Where I don't know the length of it, the building must be 200 meters. And this crack went from one side as a wide, it looked like a crack from an earthquake. And the really interesting thing about this is that, again, because it's basically a public space, people got injured, people fell in it, we had broken legs, we had the twisted ankles, which was really annoying. But what was brilliant about it is how people interact, and there's some fantastic films online of how people are playing with the artwork. Now, it's true to say, the artist wasn't exactly thrilled by this. But the moment you do this stuff in a public space, it's open for the audiences to play with it. And this, it's incredible. And you never quite know. Next year, I'm allowed to say this, there's an artist called Tino Segal, who is a really interesting artist, who is doing you're not allowed to call it this, but it's like a performance piece. Where basically there's about 100, imagine you're the audience in Tate Modern, there's about 120 actors who are just going to sort of come up to you and just do nothing, or they'll do it before. And it's going to be really weird because millions of people are going to come through this and you won't know who the actor is and who just a member of the public is. And it could go terribly wrong, I've got no idea. Or it could, my guess is it'll be fantastic. But it's about that thing about engaging with audiences in new and different ways. Now within that, there is also Tate, white walls, famous paintings, you know that, you've seen it. But the juxtaposition between the two means that multiple audiences have immensely varied sort of satisfying times when they come. And that's Tate Modern from the outside. Okay, I'm going to talk, if I may, about Gauguin, which is, and I'm talking about it because it's a relatively, those of you who work in or any part of the creative industries, Tate Modern, just to be clear, is 60% funded by the state. 60% privately funded, excuse me, and 40% funded by the state. We're in a period of cuts, as I know you have been, and the arts are being cut quite significantly in the UK. Tate's view is they want to lower their provision from the state and become more privately funded and have greater freedom. Not that the state ever says you have to spend this money this way or that way, never operates that way. But you just want to be the master of your own destiny. But at the moment, we take about 40% funding, but we will have a 15, 16% cut over the next 3 years. Some arts organizations are having cuts of 80 to 90%. Now, when we planned what we would do with the cuts, the single thing that has changed, has transformed the relationship between public and art in the UK has been in the mid-90s, many galleries became free to enter. And so Tate, you don't pay to come in, it's free. Except for the exhibitions, some exhibitions. And I say that because these exhibitions help fund everything that we're doing. So the Gauguin exhibition was the first exhibition in London for 55 years that brought together work from around the world. It's the biggest exhibition. It's now, I think, in Washington, in America. So it had to work, and it had to be brilliant, because our commercial, it has to work from a ticketing point of view, and it has to work from we want people to buy catalogues, we want people to buy T-shirts, postcards, because that funds the other stuff. The Tate is not run for profit. The Tate is run simply to provide art and to keep doing so. So this stuff has to work. So how we market it and how we sell it is incredibly important. The problem with Gauguin is that you don't think of a single image of Gauguin. If you think of Van Gogh, interestingly, I was given this earlier, you probably think of that. So I think it's really easy to market Van Gogh, quite easy. I think it's harder because you know the name Gauguin, but unless you really know art, you'll know two things. You'll know his Tahitian period or you'll know his Breton period. But it's unlikely that a single piece of artwork will shine out. In every single show that we've marketed, there's a difference in opinion between the marketing people and the curators as to what image you should use. All the curators want to use is the image that no one's ever seen, because that's amazing, because we're bringing it to the public for the first time. And I'm thinking, that's the last image I want people to see, because if we use that image, no one's going to know what on earth we're talking about. I'll show you an image in a moment that we use for the Miro show. And a Miro, I didn't realize there's a huge Miro retrospective, and if you go to London, you must go and see it, that's currently on show at Tate Modern. And Miro is a much more diverse painter than I understood him to be. I'm familiar with the Constellation work and other work, not the rest of it. And I had a particular view of how we should market Miro. The curator wanted to use a piece of work that had never been seen before. We had a bit of a discussion, verging on an argument, and I said, we can't do that because no one will know. You've got to use something familiar. With Gauguin, it's slightly different, because Gauguin, what we had to use was a single image. The other mistake that galleries and museums make is they use multiple images to market one thing. Don't. Use just one. Because out there, no one's waiting for your show. You need to help. You need to capture a tiny space of their mind with a single image that you keep repeating, keep showing them, and ultimately they might come. Eventually, we chose this image, which is a fantastic picture, and there's only one thing you'll see here where that image is not the way you've marketed it. And this is now where we're doing most shows at Tate, if not all shows at Tate, where you choose a single image, because that is the way that the audience outside might remember what you're doing. When we're marketing shows, we have a media partnership. So with the Sunday Times here, which is clearly a large newspaper in the UK, we do a media partnership. They're allowed certain privileges. They get certain amount of tickets, etc., for their readers, and they give us advertising space. We cannot afford advertising space on the national newspapers. Do a media partnership. Offer them some benefits. It works really well. With Cafe Nero, we bought here, which is a coffee shop, lots of coffee cups with Gauguin on them. Because you've got to go, if you're going to do a real blockbuster show, you have to go beyond the obvious people. So you have to get all the others to come to you. We did national ticket offers on trains. We did holiday offers. We did relationships with small luxury hotels of the world. All of that is done, particularly in Europe, because Gauguin is a big enough show that people not just in the UK, but from Europe will come to. Then we do lots of, I'm showing you the stuff that I think is less interesting. Then we do lots of posters on the underground, on buses, to make sure people know it's coming. We do quite a lot on our website, even more on our website. So by this time, you've seen this image a million times, to the point that when you enter the exhibition, it's also, as you enter, that's the image you see. So it's quite clear that's what it's about. Interestingly, we also went to Google. I don't know how many of you do this sort of stuff, Google keyword search. Here, this is in Spain, where you can buy these ones, and these ones come up with the algorithmic scale. This one here was Visit London in Spanish, and it said, if you're visiting London, go to Tate Modern to see the show. That doesn't cost anything until people click on it, and several hundred did, and they bought tickets that way. The other thing we noticed is that ticket sales are now nearly all online. They don't necessarily respond to digital advertising, but they do buy tickets online. 72% of all the tickets sold to the Gauguin show were online. Before that, it used to be about 54%, which commercially makes a real difference to how you might want to market what you're doing. This is a funny one. You know these adverts here at the top? How many of you ever click on them? Answer, none. No one ever does. This is the dark, horrible truth about advertising on the website, is that people click on Google AdWords, but they don't click on these. But these are like posters in the street. And if you're working in this area, do it for that reason. Don't expect people to click on them, come through, buy a ticket. They won't. But what these are fantastic posters on the website. Now, what we did was we bought lots of these, but we only bought them to visitors who had, when a visitor had recently been to Tate site. So we knew that they were culturally interested people, and then we kept on presenting them this. If you'd been to Tate, you might have worked out about a week later that you kept on seeing this bloody Gauguin image all the time, and we were trying to make you come to the show. We do lots of email marketing. We have about 600,000 members of Tate, 600,000 email addresses. There are 100,000 members of Tate, and every member has is allowed to bring a friend. So essentially, for every member who pays between £50 and £90 a year, that accounts for two people. But we have about 600,000 email addresses of people who said, yes, we'd like to hear from you. Gather as many email addresses as you can, because this is the way to do incredibly effective, incredibly cheap, very effective marketing. It works brilliantly, as long as you do it the right way. As you're not spamming people, you're telling them interesting things. And I go back to my earlier point about you're not chocolate manufacturers, you're a gallery. So what you have is intrinsically interesting. And if people are giving their email addresses to a gallery, my sense is they actually want to hear from you. And you can email them far more often than people generally think. This is where it got really interesting, because all the other stuff, I think, is what you should do anyway. This was the first time it got very interesting. We'd never done this before at the Tate. This is a lady called Christine Riding, and this is Nick Sirota. Nick Sirota is the director of the Tate. Nick did not employ me for my art knowledge. He employed me because he wanted to do all this sort of stuff. Because he is sitting on one of the world's great galleries and he wants people to know much more about it. One of the problems for me in the world of art and galleries is it's fundamentally very elitist and it doesn't allow for, but actually I don't think it has to be elitist. And what we need to do is lift the lid on the gallery world and allow audiences to look in and engage, which is quite risky. But I think as a publicly funded organization, which is 40% of what we are, I think it's imperative that we do. Nick has never blogged before, and I said to Nick, in the same way that Alan Ruswager at The Guardian had said, you better join Facebook, you better Twitter, Nick, I need you to start blogging. If you do it, other people in the organization will. If you don't, I can guarantee you people won't. So here's Nick, and for the first time, he actually blogged, and it was really interesting, and what he had to say was interesting. And it wasn't Nick speaking formally as either an academic or Nick speaking formally as the director of Tate. It was Nick saying why he loves Paul Gauguin, which you generally don't hear him talking about, and it was a lovely blog. Christine is the curator of the exhibition. Christine's a very progressive curator. This is her sitting in her office with all the pictures that she wanted to have. Document everything, by the way, because you never know when you might want to use it. And we took this picture of Christine in her office, and we didn't know when we'd use it. Christine then blogged, I think it was 34 or 36 blog posts, about 36 blog posts up there. And those 36 blog posts were anything from pictures of the opening night of the show, to why her favorite picture. And for me, the most interesting one was where she chose a picture and asked people, you know the bit of text next to a painting, the interpretation that's in many galleries, which many people find very confusing and don't really understand how it's written. She said, what would you write? Give me the 80 words that you would write on this particular painting. And about 150 people did. And if 150 people did, you can multiply that by at least 10 or 20 to the amount of people who then read it. So I'm pretty sure that thousands would have read it. Because for every, there's a general rule, it's 99-1. For every 1% who writes, there are 99% who actually will read it. Now here, there were many blog posts. In the end, it was less than 6 months, it was about 4 to 5 months. We had 250,000 page views and around 1,200 comments for the Gauguin show. Now, what's interesting about this is that the way people don't actually come to Tate's website very often for this sort of stuff. The way you need to do it is back to our old friends of Facebook and Twitter. Because if you're sending out a new blog post on Facebook or a new blog post on Twitter, that's how they come back to your website. People are not coming to Tate yet to hear the discussion and debate on art. But in 2 to 3 years, I think they will. This is the area that we are growing the most, and I'll show you how we're doing it on our website. Every now exhibition we do is blogged. all of them, we are asking conservators to blog, major exhibitions to blog, and it's changing the face of how Tate is going to be in the future. And what we want to do is to open it up to public debate, open it up to public scrutiny, and have the debate about either historical or contemporary art within the website that's Tate. And this is sort of the word, we did a big word cloud of what they were talking about. There was, in the newspapers, just before the show ended, there was an article in the newspaper, which was one of the silliest articles I've read for a long time, where they said that people were expressing fury and gallery rage because there were too many people in the exhibition. Now, it's true, the last 2 weeks, this became a massive show. And one of the reasons it became a massive show was all the work we'd done in the online space. The only thing that's different in the way we marketed this show to how we've marketed other shows was the digital and online presence. So apart from it being a great show, that's the thing that was different, and that's the thing that will have driven more and more people. And by the last 2 weeks, you know, everyone thinks, oh, I haven't seen the show yet, I must see it, so they rush to go and see it. So it was pretty crowded. My own views will come earlier, there's nothing I can do about it. It was compounded by the fact that we had terrible weather over Christmas and you couldn't go anywhere because there's lots of snow in London, so people got very cross. Tough. But the truth is, the crowded bit is very small, it's there, compared to the rest of the word cloud. So people weren't that worried about it, but the newspapers made a real stink about it. So social media, these figures have now changed. We have many more than that now, but please engage in it. Data capture is the other really big thing. We're now obsessed with this, about capturing data of people who come to Tate. Not because we want to misuse that data, and we will never sell that data to anyone. It's just for us to engage with that particular audience. Now, and we did radio advertising. The point about people don't go to your website is a big one. This is a film that we made about Paul Gauguin's life. Now, I know that if we just put it on the Tate's website, very few people will see it. So I rang The Guardian, some ex-friends of The Guardian, said, can we put it on your website? They did. Thousands of people viewed it. So you have to distribute your content. People don't expect people to come to your site. Distribute it absolutely everywhere. In the old days, everyone said, no, we're going to close it off, and we're going to, you know, it's going to be a closed wall. Completely open, as porous as you possibly can be. We also did an app. So, and everyone's talking about apps, and I'm not really sure what to think about apps. I'm really unclear about them. This was an app we did for the Gauguin show, where it was brilliant. You could download it on iTunes. You still can, actually. And it was a tour around the gallery with pictures, with audio. Only 1,538 people downloaded this out of 420-something thousand who came to go and see it. Now, I don't know if that's good or bad, but I do know that this is going to be part of the future of how we engage with audiences. So you sort of have to do it, and I'm going to keep doing it. This one cost cost 79p, and only 1,500 people download it. We have another one called, there's an Edward Muybridge. And Edward Muybridge was the American photographer who worked out, there's that famous picture of a horse with all four legs off the ground, which is, you know, so horses can fly. In the late 19th century. And we created an app called a Muybridgeizer, where basically you can take any image and do that thing which looks like an Edward Muybridge photograph. It's been downloaded over 110,000 times. Now, I don't know if that's because it's free or because it's really good. I think it's something to do with both of it. So I don't know, but I have to keep doing it because I think one has to. So we ended up, all our exhibitions, if you look at the yellow line, every single exhibition you ever do will start with lots of audiences at the beginning. It'll then tail off. It'll then keep tailing off. And then at the end, it'll go crazy again. The yellow line is what you expect an audience to happen. The blue line is actually what happened. We started off where we thought we would, which was just about 4,000 a day. But the incredible thing was, as the social media thing started to happen, the 4,000 stayed, and it should have gone down. Because most shows go down. And the gap between this and this is the extra people who came to the show that we were surprised. Oh, and by the way, this was the most expensive show that Tate has ever done. This cost £15 a ticket, which we're not happy with. We would rather it cost £1. I take no pleasure in this. But the interesting thing about it is that the resistance you get from inside a gallery is often, well, no, if we put it a lot of money, people won't come. Well, they did come, and they came in their thousands, and they paid the £15 because it worked. So the price and demand issue is much more complicated than people think. And people were very uncomfortable with a £15 price ticket. So were we, because we don't want to do it. But we had to do it to make ends meet and to pay for the show. And it worked. So this gap continued. And it only was here. This is where the terrible weather happened in London. And for any of you who are in London, you couldn't fly anywhere, you couldn't go anywhere. I think it was the weather, and it was the Icelandic volcano that blew up. And then here, this is when people thought, oh my God, I've only got 2 weeks to go into this show, I must go into the show. And they all came, and here, you know, you're up to over 5,500 people a day, which is a bit mad. So that's what happened. And at the end, we ended up, we estimated 315,000 people would come. We've done many exhibitions at the Tate, so we're generally wrong by between 10 and 15% either way, either underestimate or overestimate. We estimated 315,000, 420,000 people came. It became the third most successful show the Tate had ever had, and financially, which sadly does matter, because it's incredibly important, because then it allows us to do other stuff that is frankly for minority audiences, not just the blockbuster stuff. It's the show that generated more money than any other show in the history of the Tate, which is incredibly important to our future funding and our ability to deliver artworks that are not like this, that are different. So that's the case study I want to show you. Can I just run you through very quickly, if I may, the changes to our website? Because I started by saying how rubbish websites are, and I want to show you how rubbish our website is at the moment. And I say that I'm responsible for it, so I can say that. It looks like this at the moment. And it's basically a website that's about 10 years out of date. It's a completely push website. And it looks like a web... we're trying to sell you everything. Everything is sell. And it's almost morally wrong. But it's certainly wrong from the point of view of audience interest. People don't come to the Tate website to be sold to. I mean, they might, if they want to buy a ticket. They want to engage with the Tate. But this is just selling like crazy. The new website is going to look a little different. So picture that in your head if you can. We had 10 principles for Tate's online website. Tate's website is for, I don't know why it's gone 1357, but there are 10. Tate's website is for Tate's online audience. That sounds like a really stupid thing to say, but galleries are not created with the audience in mind in the first place. They're created by brilliant curators who have stuff to show that they want to show. You have to take a different approach to your website. Because people, it's a different medium, it's a different way of doing it. And if you let curators run a website, it would look interesting, but probably not. People would have... Now, that's not to be critical of curators. They develop art for galleries, and I think the website thing is different. We actually do lots of research on our website, and there's been some very interesting findings on the research. In museum speak, you talk about the collection, and you talk about the display exhibition. Now, the collection is the stuff that's owned by the museum. In our case, owned, we're looking after it on behalf of the nation. The display is the stuff like Gauguin, where you pay £15 to come and see. No one has a clue what we're talking about. But yet, on the website, we talk about display collection, no one knows what we're talking about. So we will not be talking that way on the website anymore. It's going to change. So the website is both a platform for publication and for interaction, which is, at the moment, it's just a platform for publication. You can interact on our website, but it's buried so deep that you'd never be able to find it. The website should be alive with thoughts, conversations, and opinion. It isn't at the moment, but it will be. Online content, commerce, and community should be intermixed. You shouldn't have big selling pages and then big curatorial. Mix it. That's a much more subtle way of doing it. All web pages are the start of a range of possible user journeys. In the old days, everyone thought, no, they come into the homepage. And they don't come into the homepage at all. They come in where they choose to come. But whatever page you come into the new Tate website, you'll be able to take a journey around the entire website, if you wish, very easily. You shouldn't have to come to the homepage at all. Content owners manage their own content. We do not have 10 people working in my department who sit just doing. I want people to be able to upload their own stuff from all around the building, which is incredibly complex from a governance point of view. But you have to do that. It's never going to happen if you have a funnel which works that way. It has to be the other way, which allows anyone in the organization to contribute. It requires a lot of trust. It's quite difficult, but that's how we're going to do it. Online content needs to be opened and shared. Content and interaction should be taken to the online audience. Personalization is a big part of it, and the website must be sustainable. Our feeling is that once we do this, within 2 years, we're going to have to sort of keep changing and keep developing it. I'm going to rush through this, actually. That's what the old one looked like. That was what the Goga. How silly is that? Ooh, now open on late on Sundays. Come on. Which is sort of, it's too much. It's not right. This is what it's going to look like, which is going to be completely different. It will focus much more on the art. It will sell a lot less. And we'll always have a thread of discussion on the homepage. So we will have a huge blogging area and discussion zone, and we will always pull an interesting thread, and any time you open it will open, or the homepage will open, if you open the homepage, with a thread from either a curator or a member of the public that leads to a discussion and a debate. This is Tate Liverpool, which will look like that. You'll notice here that it still says collection. Okay, that's what it's not going to say that. I'll show you what it'll say in a minute, but that's what it used to say. And then we did some research with audiences and realized they didn't have a clue what collection meant. What are you talking about? Could you please speak in English, not in art speak? A little bit more here. And again, here, it's embedded everywhere, all of which is obvious now. And if you work in the new media, you know this, but lots of galleries don't. The whole following Tate, whether it's Flickr, whether it's Facebook, whether it's Twitter, just you need to embed this absolutely everywhere. The big change here is this. It's gone from collection to art and artists, which again sounds really small. But where I started from, galleries and museums are fundamentally conservative and fundamentally progressive at the same time. And so the transition from collection to art and artists, I have to tell you, was hours of discussion. To me, it's worth a one-minute discussion, but there are strong folk who are very uncomfortable with the change. And I respect their view. Here, the bit I want to show you, I'm just going to show you some pages, is this is what the blog space is going to look like, where we will take threads and discussions. And here you see some of the discussion points, the comments at the bottom in the green, red, and pink. This is where it gets brilliant. The Tate has 72,000 pieces of artwork, which is it's looking after for the nation. And here we have put in the word portrait as our search term. Okay, and every single piece of artwork will be uploaded, whether it's a piece of Turner scribble, a Turner art book rather than the bigger paintings. And so you can sort it how you like. Here it's sorted it by date, and you can show all the portraits that way, and it has a little bit about them. So you can list them all here. There's 2,658 works that way. You can look at them that way if you like. You can also search the artwork by any word you like. If you want to do it by mood words, I'm depressed. All the pictures with depression will come up because you hashtag them all. If you want to do it through joy or happiness or pink fluffy dogs or cats or animals or whatever you want, you can search however you want, which is remarkable for a museum website. And it's going to allow people to engage in a way that is how they want to engage, which I'm incredibly excited about. So you've pulled out a painting that you want to find more about. Up it comes. You can pull it out further. And here, the painting will tell you, this isn't factually true, by the way, but it'll say, here's the gallery, this is where it was painted, here's some stuff about the artist, here's some stuff about the artwork itself. Then it will say, if you like that painting, you might like these, a bit like Amazon Books, which for the world of art is really, really interesting, because these steps are quite difficult to take in that conservative and progressive world at the same time. So for some more art by the same artist, you can discuss it, and again, if you want to go and see some other works like it. Now here, we've got all the artworks again listed by art and artist. And then if you want to see the work, you can bring it up like that. But even better, if you want, you can just see it like that with absolutely no words at all. And if you really want to, we'll have a program here that will allow you to click a button. And you know, if you've got a Mac, or maybe it works on PCs, you know how you can change your background photo to every 3 seconds? You can have the entire Tate collection changing every 3 seconds, and you can view everything. And I think that's fantastic, because it's just bringing what is owned by the public to the public in multiple ways which they can engage with it. And I'm incredibly excited about that, because it's going to change the way that we work with, engage with our audiences. So the last thing I want to say, and this isn't meant to be a lecture about websites, it's meant to be how audiences engage with museums and galleries, is that your website should operate as 3 layers. It operates as a brochure, which is what our old website does, if you think about it. It should exist as a channel of content, but mostly, in my view, it should engage as an interactive platform, because I think we have the content that people want to engage with, either in a very trivial way, or a very formal way, or a very academic way, and we have to meet all the requirements of those different audiences. And that's it. Thank you very much. And happy to answer any questions or no questions or as you wish.
You were telling about content distribution. What about your collaborations, for instance, Europeana? Are you connected? Europeana.
Yeah.
Do you distribute your...
Yes, we do. And our view again on that is we should be involved exactly in projects like that. There's another project called the Public Catalogue Foundation in the UK, where the BBC are taking every piece of every painting that is owned in the public domain, and it should be available to view. Some galleries don't want to do it because they're like, "Oh no, if you take it off our website, then it won't be people won't come back to our website." We've said yes to all the paintings, but the stipulation on that is that we will limit the words of description on the painting. So you come back to the Tate's website for the full detail. So you'll have an image, and the image will be a good image. It won't be a low pixel image, but we will be on that website. But there will be multiple links to come back to Tate. Because I think what I want is the content broadly distributed, whether it's Europeana or PCF, and then you come back to Tate's website for the detail. And that's basically our principle.
How do you use your audience feedback in your Twitter or any other online medium?
Let me show you something here, which is hopefully... If you go to Tate, our blog at the moment looks like this. And here, if you go to Miro... This is the live version of our blog, and here... There's a watercolor exhibition. There's a Miro show. On the Miro show, we have asked audiences to respond. If you come to Miro as a member, so I'm just trying to find it here, I'm sorry, when you come to the exhibition, you get an automatic email that then asks you what you thought of the show. And if you want to send it in, you can. If you don't, that's absolutely fine. But so I'm just trying to, here we go. All right, so here's the Miro show, and here's the comments. This is one, there's another comment here that has about 200 comments. this is what people are saying about it. Here, we thought the show was fun. These are some of them, they're not all good, by the way. Some of them are not good, but we put them all up. And it's very difficult to know what to do with them. You don't have to reply to all of them, but you have to reply to some of them. On the one hand, we reply to quite a lot, but on the other hand, we aggregate the comments and then bring them back to the curatorial teams. I'm not that interested in the comments that say, I didn't like that painting, I did like that painting. That's life. I'm very interested in the comments that relate to how we laid the show out, some of the physical aspects of the show. There was a very interesting set of comments on the Gauguin show, which was much loved and people loved it and all that. They hated the lighting of the show. Some of the rooms they thought were wrongly lit. And the thing they couldn't work out was the text on the paintings was very small. Could you please make it much bigger if you have a blockbuster show? Now, it sounds like a really simple criticism, but you have to listen to that. And we've now changed some of the procedures that we do on the basis of that, because I think you have to. But I think you have to separate the comments from, I loved the artwork, I didn't love the artwork, to the experience they had visiting the gallery and exhibition. Because I don't think it is the role of curator. I don't think that audiences or research should be telling curators what to show. But I think they will help curators the next time to make what they want to show be better received. So it's quite difficult to incorporate some of the comments. Some are very easy, some are difficult. For curators, this can be very painful. And it was exactly the same for newspaper journalists. When newspaper journalists 10 years ago started putting their stuff online and you could comment, the last thing newspaper journalists meant it wanted the opinions of their readers. They hated it. That's changed now because they're working out how to interact with their audiences. But it's taken a long time to change, and it will take us a long time. But it's a very difficult area, but a very healthy area, in my view.
May I ask, how big was your team to build up this Gauguin campaign?
Well, there's, the curatorial team is a regular curatorial size. For this, there are two people in marketing, and there are about two people on the website, and me, and a couple of others. But it's not hundreds of people. But we planned it incredibly carefully. And the key thing on this, one of the difficulties with museums and galleries is often I find that the curatorial people don't necessarily know the marketing people, and they don't really want to know them. That's okay. When you sit in a room with them, it works a lot better, and you need to sit in a room. So on this, we met every single week for half an hour with the curatorial teams for about 2 months before the show started, just to discuss what we were doing, what the changes were, and it ended up being very, very... And we now have a model by which we do it. So the Miro show, which is up now, same model. There was a show for Gabriella Rothko, which has just finished, same model. We now have a checklist, we have a way of doing it, which will change, but basically it's how we do it. It's not hundreds of people. And I don't want you to think that just because it's the Tate, because it's Tate's very big and has lots of money, it's easier. I accept that it is easier, but it's an approach rather than the money.
Yes, I just want to ask that, of course, you outsource from agencies some work. You can't just do, ad agencies or internet agencies.
No, we do it all ourselves. We do it all ourselves.
Is it all work and
yes.
Posters and everything?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. We do it all ourselves. We used to do much more outside. And since I came, I said I want to do much more inside because I want it to be a reflection of the Tate, not a reflection of an advertising agency.
Excuse me, but do you actually market a lot internationally? Let's say, would that show in France?
Only through the websites and through Google's AdWords and through banner ads. We don't spend vast sums of money. But this is where, once again, the online space gets very interesting. We have thousands of Twitter followers in France and Spain. When they retweet it, it goes round to thousands more. So we don't spend money, but we spend time in with particular audiences and constituencies, and it does work.
But actually, on the website, if you have that content on Twitter or on Facebook, who keeps it fresh? Because it actually takes a lot of effort.
Yeah, it's a great question. It does take. We have one person who is responsible for tweeting and Facebook, and he. But again, it's his responsibility to make sure it's updated the whole time. He doesn't do it all himself, but he's engaging people around the gallery to put the content up, because one person can't do it. But it does take time and it does take effort. It doesn't take many people, but it does take time and effort.
And it will take a lot more effort than this new webpage, I
can imagine. Yes. The new website, because it's being editorialized, we're having to change how we do it, because it's going to work much more like a, not a newspaper function, but an editorial function. And so we are taking, I'm going to employ different people and change how people internally work to deliver that, because you can't do it otherwise. Because it needs to change, every day needs to be a new discussion, new topic, and we will change how we do it.
Has somebody used this model already in the US, let's say,
I think that you learn much more by going outside your own industry. I've learned nothing about web usage by looking in the world of galleries and museums. I've learned everything by working in newspapers and looking at the world of retail in terms of how to do it. You spend time in the gallery world, you'll learn nothing of interest apart from MoMA and the Met in New York and the Tate. And even the Tate, I'd argue, you would learn, it will be, but it's moving that way. Don't spend your time looking inside that world. Go outside it. Always.
Can you also ask about your audience engagement for the new website? First of all, is your team expanding within the Tate? And also regarding the audiences, do you put more time into development? Do you test it with the users before the launch? It's a really big launch, I understand.
In terms of the skill base, the size of the web team is about 12 people. Which you might argue is big, you might argue is small, I don't know. In terms of user testing, we have tested all of this. Now, again, not with thousands of people you don't need to do it. We've done 4 user testing groups on the design of the website. And that way, and those user tests are segmented by, there's a group of academics, there's a group of students, there's a group of people like me who know a bit about art, but not a lot about art, but want to engage in it. And there's a group of people who are professional artists. So we have taken different groups and sought their views on it and have amended it accordingly. And that's why it's become what it's become. So, and that has been very interesting, because the world of galleries and museums is not one that where they do much research. And actually, it's been welcomed, very much so.
I have a question about the research methods that you're using. Like you were saying that you decided to change the word collection. Mm. Like, how do you get that kind of information? Are you actually employing like a research team, like you're outsourcing?
Okay, what we did was we had some dummy versions of the website, and we did some research where we employed an outside research company, and we got the different segments I just described to play with the website. We also sat behind a mirror and watched them playing with the websites. Because you can watch, there's nothing better than seeing someone doing it to realize what's wrong and what's right. And on the collection issue, you could see that there are two things they didn't understand. One was collection and the other was learning. What is learning? All museums, and it's an important part of a museum's life, and learning with audiences, engaging with audience to teach them what's going on. They didn't understand learning, they didn't understand collection. They told us, what do you mean by collection? I don't understand what you're talking about. When you hear that from people, you can't ignore it. And that's how it got changed. It then got fed back, and then we then talked internally. Now, what comes back is, well, you only talk to 30 people, so how can that be true? You only need to talk to 30 people. You don't need to talk. Statistically, that's probably enough. So you don't need to do research amongst thousands of people. And any researcher will tell you that that's, if you're finding a problem, the same problem coming up with more than 10 people, it's a problem, you better sort it out. We then took it back in again, and then we had some ideas, and then we went back out again. So what if we called it this? What if we called it that? Would that help you explain it? So it's quite simple, but it's quite difficult internally.
Did you have any good idea related to all those ways to communicate. Some good idea that didn't materialize, or you realize that it takes too much effort to make it happen, that you had to leave behind?
Yes, the idea, that moment that's frustrating us most of all, is, you know, the application I showed you from Museums of London, where you can take a picture and you can put it where you are. We want to do that with all of Tate's works, which is 72,000. If you take out the Turner, it's 35,000 pieces of artwork. And you just can't, it's costing it, we can't do it, cost too much money. We will do it, but we will build it up slowly. Because I know that if you go to Constable country, which is between the border of Essex and Suffolk, which is a really beautiful part of England, and you know that Constable painted here, because you know. And if you don't know, and you do a bit of research, the first thing will come up will be Constable. You sort of want to see where, you want to go where he painted the hay wain or other thing. And you want to then find the artwork, and then you want to, and we can't do it. It's a great idea that we can't do. The Museum of London is a much smaller, and we haven't worked out how to do it yet.
Do you collaborate a lot with students, art schools, universities?
Yes, we do. We do a few things. The Tate is a very interesting organisation in that it's both... It's a really big beast in the world of art galleries, and is sometimes... You have to be careful, because you can dominate in a way that you don't particularly want to. So I suppose we do a lot of work with students, both formal work, but also informal work. One of the things we do, we have taken 19 galleries, very small galleries, around the country, who are tiny, and we have a thing called Plus Tate. So if you have, there's a gallery recently opened called the Turner Contemporary Gallery in Margate. It opened 3 weeks ago. We have a formal affiliation with them called Plus Tate, which is a mixture of, if you want some experience in marketing to help you, ring me and I'll come down, or someone else will help you. If you want particular loans of paintings, we will help you. If you want some expertise on conservation, we will help you. So it's like a big outreach program to ensure that our skills can help other galleries as well, because we are in a slightly privileged position and we want to help them. We're not in a commercially competitive environment. We're trying to all make the art world more accessible and bigger, and so we share lots of knowledge. We have really strong relations with all the art colleges in the UK.
Yeah, I was just thinking to make the students their knowledge to work within your own interests.
Yeah. There's an example at the moment. Tate Britain, we're doing a big marketing campaign for Tate Britain at the moment. Because if you've been to London, there's Tate Modern, which is obvious what it is. It's all the modern work. It's a contemporary modern museum. And then there's Tate Britain. And no one knows really what's in Tate Britain. They all think it's just old stuff or the historical works. And it isn't, actually. Tate Britain is a mixture of historical and modern and contemporary, of which the link is all the artists are either British or have worked in Britain, whereas Tate Modern is truly international, but Tate Britain is British artists. So we have a big marketing campaign at the moment which is explaining what the gallery is, because after 100 years, people still don't know what's in it. Chelsea Art College is next to Tate Britain. So myself and a curator went to go and see them. And there's a lot of work happening at Tate Britain. It's being refurbished at the moment. And so there's scaffolding outside the building. And there's a poster. There's a poster site, which is about the size of this room, there and there, outside the whole front of the building. And we went to Chelsea Art College and said to them, what do you think should be on? There's a big piece of nasty scaffolding. Help us create an artwork to put on the building. And we, in fact, when I go back on Sunday, on Monday, I'm judging the competition as to what goes up. And it's being done by fine art students and design students, which will be interesting. It's just an interesting way of looking at it.
And just one last question, that the 60% of financing in the country comes from private funds. Is it private people as well as collectioners?
Yeah, it's a mixture of ticket revenue, membership revenue. If you go to the Tate galleries, they have quite big shops. Pardon? Oh, to become a member, if you spend £50 to £90 a year, means you can come to the gallery. You don't pay to see the exhibitions. You can come as many times as you like, so you don't pay the £15. And you can also have, you know, curator will take you around and explain it to you. So it's like a fantastic club. The revenue comes from membership revenue. It comes from the shops in the galleries, which generates a lot of money. It comes from private donations. It comes from all sorts of donations, but mostly from shops, membership, and private donations, and sponsors.
Yeah, I don't know if you can say that, but how big is that part of that private donation?
I can't really say that, but it's big. It's big. It's not, but the bigger portion. It's probably about half of it. No, 2/3 of it is only about 1/3 of it is private donations. Probably less than that.
Going back to the very beginning of your speech, talking about the business side and content creation side, and if you're giving up such a fantastic web page where you just can go into very deep of the piece of artwork, what is your vision in that sense that maybe in some time even makes the number of visitors smaller and smaller because it's so convenient?
The question.
People, etc., the gallery.
The question at the front was, if you're doing all this on your website, maybe fewer and fewer people will come and see the work in the gallery. So the last thing I showed you was a very high resolution image on a full screen of a wonderful artwork, and frankly, you can see everything if you put it on the click that button. The answer to that question is not clear. I personally think that it's not an either-or relationship. And this is the mistake that many industries have made. Newspapers made the same mistake. This is an unstoppable force of what is going on, and you cannot restrict. One thing you've learned from the world, we've all learned in the world of the digital space, is the notion of restriction doesn't work. So you can either try and restrict it and try and keep stuff off, but it will get there in the end if people want it. Or you can just say, here goes. I have enough faith that the experience of viewing an artwork for real is infinitely, it's not even different, it's better. And so I don't think it will have a negative effect at all on visitors. If anything, if you've seen a great painting online and you've engaged with it in some way, it is only going to make you want to come and see it even more. I could be completely wrong, but that is my fervent view on this. The benefit, however, of audiences who are unable to view your work because they don't live anywhere near where it's showing, or they can't afford, whatever the reason, far outweighs the possibility of that being a problem. And our remit at Tate is to engage the nation in stuff that they own. So who am I to say, I'm not going to let you see it this way? I've got to be able to let you see it any way you want to see it. Now, the ideal scenario is that lots of people view it this way and lots of people view it in the flesh. And I think that's exactly what will happen, because I think it will only make you want to come and see the real thing. When I showed you the sun there, that's not what it was. I mean, it was, that's what it looks like. But when you're in it, when you feel it, when you engage with it, you have an emotional engagement with it. It's impossible to have an emotional engagement with that picture. But you're in it, and you'd be blown away. And it's the same with Gauguin. I could show you all the pictures. It's not the same. And I think that's a real truth. So I'm not worried about that.
I'm afraid we need to finish now because. Need to take Mark to the end. I'm sorry, we are extremely grateful. Something that is going to be only a trip to Paranormal Managers Conference has turned into a tour over Australia.
It's great.
And I think we are extremely grateful to Mark for agreeing to do this 1.5-hour session here. So shall we give him a big round of applause?
Thank you very much.